return on sales of 10%. The firm generates $2.40 in sales per dollar of assets, or 2.40 in sales per dollar of assets. What is the firm's return on investment? Okay, to get return on investment, it's net income over equity. To do this, you take the 0.75 from the tax burden, the 0.6 from the interest burden, the 0.1 or 10%, and the return on sales, the 2.4 from the firm's generated dollars per asset, sorry.
That's cool.
And you get 0.135, which you change to 13.5%, which is your return on income, or return on investment.
That's easy. Hey, anybody else? Anybody else on the problem? Alfred's going to do this. And then we'll get started. So pull out your blue books. Does anybody need a blue book? Any extra blue books? Did you forget your blue books? Or you have your blue book? Do you need more blue books?
So you let someone slip down.
Chapter 19, problem 6. Says firm A and firm B have the same ROA, yet firm A's ROE is higher. How can you explain this?
So this is a pretty simple explanation. So this is the ROE equation, which is 1 minus the tax rate times ROA plus ROA subtracted by the interest rate times debt to equity. So the ROA could be the same, but there could be a difference on the tax rate for your debt to equity.
So why would A's be higher?
Tax rate lower, or debt to equity would be higher.
So, test question. Can the tax rate go negative?
Yes.
Can it?
No.
No. On a marginal basis?
Oh, it could. You're saying the tax
rate. Effective, but on a marginal basis?
Oh, no.
Yeah. Can I lever up the firm as far as I want?
Sure. Yeah.
Can I have debt to equity as high as I can?
Yeah.
Can I? Legally, Miller? Can I lever up the firm as much as I want to juice the ROE?
No.
So what's the debt to equity or debt to total market cap? What's the benchmark that we would use to measure if a firm's over under leverage?
60-40 something.
Yeah, what would we use? Would we use the industry peer group or the direct competitor?
Industry
peer group.
Peer group.
Peer group. Got it. Just testing.
Come on.
Anybody got a pen? We'll do options on that.
No.
Wednesday in front of you.
Oh,
great work problems. That'd be great for papers. So I didn't get to it. Yes, sir.
We'll also do the mid term. You also want to do the options?
No, we're just going to focus on the problems. Just the problems. I'll bring in the problems. You can put them up on the board, present them. I'll work on the problems, and then you guys work on the problems. But I would go ahead and read the chat. Okay, so let's keep going on the construction. Where did we leave off?
Slide 49. It was basically the market selection, the metro area identification slide.
Yeah. I'll go back and do that because that was a pretty innovative piece. Because what I did was I basically took the factors, employment, renter population, home prices, I took all those factors. What I did was I created z-scores. Is everybody familiar with z-scores? Yes? No?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Z-scores. Z-scores are great because they're standardized measures. So if I have a metro area of 315 metros or 50 metros where the sample size is large enough, I can basically get the statistics for the sample and create a z-score, which is a standardized score. Okay? And I can do that for each of them. And the z-score, what is the z-score?
The number of standard deviations from the mean a data point is.
Yeah, exactly. So basically, you got x minus x hat divided by our standard deviation. So basically, you're controlling for the skewness in the distribution. So you're taking basically the square root of the variance here. It's not to the second power, but it's just the dispersion divided by the standard deviation creates a normal distribution. And these become standardized scores. And you can weight them. So it's a very innovative, very quick way to basically be able to standardize the variables, weight them, create a composite index, and then re-rank them. And that's basically what I got. This was pretty innovative too, as I used a multi-method approach. I had a forecast regression model, and I had a point scoring system. And then basically use both to rank the metros and see if they came up with the same rankings. So the board was asking me, well, how did you come up with those rankings? Well, I built a regression model, showed them that, and then showed them the point scoring system, and the results were basically the same. So it validated the rankings for the metros that we were selecting to invest in. And then I had to go into the literature and look for the models. I had to collect all the data, standardize the data, clean the data. Then I had to test all the variables, the inventory. I even used what was called are you guys familiar with stepwise regression? Stepwise regression. Stepwise regression is a data mining tool where basically you will put all of the variables, let's say I'm trying to predict revenue or net operating income growth for each metro, to basically build the model, but I don't limit the variables, I put all the variables, my data inventory, into the frickin' machine. And then I click on, I go to SPSS or SAS or MATLAB or R or Python or whatever you're using, and you can run a stepwise regression procedure on it. And what it'll do is it'll put together the combinations of the variables to minimize the mean squared error, the F statistics and the T statistics for the individual variables and the adjusted R squared. So it does it automatically, okay? It's a data mining tool. But what you do is you use that tool to basically see what other external variables from the literature and internal variables presented to you by management. And if you got the automated approach and you got these variables and you got other variables from the literature and your management, you can put together the best model. So it's just an automated procedure to test your variables and get a regression model with the minimal mean squared error. Am I speaking over everybody's head here? Do you understand? Because you're going to be in finance and you're doing data analysis, or any kind of data analysis, you're going to be building regression models. Okay? And you're probably going to be working with a statistician and a data scientist. And these guys are going to be talking at really high levels, just like I just talked, and you got to be able to follow them.
So essentially, you put all these variables into this stepwise.
I put the whole thing, the whole kitchen sink. I basically have basically a bathtub full of variables that I got from my inventory, and I basically clean up the data into one big data set, and then I basically push the stepwise regression procedure, and it nowadays it would take hours or days, you know, in the 80s or 90s, now can be done in basically 2 minutes.
And it gives
so it's
you
a factorial combinations of variables.
And it gives you the weights?
And it basically gives you the coefficients, it gives you the reduced model. But it's a data mining, it's a kind of a garbage can approach. But usually you're going to pick up some variables that should be in your model through that unbiased approach. And then you compare that to what management said and what the literature said, and you put together your best model from the two procedures. And then you rank the metros based on the scoring system and the regression model. And then from the regression model, like you project the rates of return like you did for the 2018 for your stocks. And basically it's going to pump out through the optimization, both the economic base and both the geographic diversification, I used an indexed approach, and I used the Excel optimization program. So I had basically an indexed approach and I had an optimization to then basically determine the target geographic weights and then determine the target economic base weights by geography. Okay. And then once you get the metro weights, you know what the allocations are. You take basically, we were going to be a $5 billion company. Take the weights, multiply it by the $5 billion, that's my target. Subtract out what the current allocation is, that's my variance, now we know where we need to buy it for the next 5 years. Go get it. Go to it, you guys. And that's what they did. So it took a year to build the methodology, it took them 3 years to use the portfolio, and then took them an additional 5 years to go out further on the official frontier. And then they were pretty much rewarded for it by the marketplace until they totally screwed up on their developments and basically ran the company into the ground and got taken out by another large company for a 20% premium. So the models that I used the cross-section regression and I used the z-score point scoring systems. Then went through, did all the literature, as I talked about before. I built the macro housing model. There's the variables right there that predict housing demand, and apartments are part of overall housing. And I built the supply regression model. These are the variables. And actually what I thought was interesting was the CPI and consumer confidence were actually leading indicators to supply. And this was all verified through the literature. Then built the weighting systems. There's volatility measures, housing affordability, employment, population growth. These are fundamental demand factors, supply factors, multifamily permitting, new construction, supply to demand ratios, and then scaling factors, just the size of the market. And then weighted the z-scores by these weights to get composite scores, yes.
Now, you said you were doing this around the time of, you know, the market crash and everything in 08. How relevant was the data from 03 and like 97?
This is all pretty much very stable coefficients. Plus, I had worked with the chairman of the board of directors who ran a consulting and an advisory firm. He'd run multiple companies, advisory companies and consulting companies with really smart modeling people, and he basically worked with me on some of the demand. He wanted to have more of a demand-weighted model where two-thirds of the demand would come from the demand factors, or the model would come from the demand factors. About 20% would come from the supply factors and 10% would be control factors. That's kind of how we came up with that.
So
then we calculated all the z-scores for all the factors, for all the metrics, weighted them, and then calculated the composite indexes and then rated them.
Okay.
So we knew, based on the unbiased research approach, we knew we wanted to be out of Vegas and Albuquerque, Portland, Vegas, and Tucson. It's like, let's get out of here, sell, take all of our money that we're raising with debt and equity, take all the money that we sold off of these commodity markets and redeploy them up here in development, which they did. And they did a really good job of execution, although the company really didn't have superior development capabilities, so they made some mistakes on the development and that eventually led them to being taken out some years later.
When you're talking about the classification, what would bump something from developing to developed, or like how would you know?
These are all commodity markets, so they always underperform. These are supply constrained, high tech, concentrated markets. They've always overperformed. It's easy to buy and build down here. It's hard to buy and build up. So I said, you know, I don't care. You guys figure out how to buy and build up here, because this is, we're always going to outperform if we can build our portfolio here. Well, our shareholders will always be rewarded.
And are they doing complete development, or is this like value add?
A little value add, but we moved into ground up development, which was a new capability for us. And we had a bunch of guys who were incompetent, and a few of the projects really got screwed up. We went from a 8% IRR to 3% because of the cost overruns, because they totally screwed up on the development. It's really risky. You make one mistake, you're done on the project. And we got sued, too, by a co-investor. Then what we did is, once we had the metro rankings, we said, well, where by submarket do we want to invest? So basically, I ran the same models, looked at the literature, and built basically composite models, factor models, to be able to pick the submarkets. Because once you know the metro, now, what submarkets do we specifically go into and invest? And I used two different models. I used adjusted R-square model, and then I used a point scoring system. And as you can see in yellow, is there's overlap in the variables between the two methodologies, which you want. That's why I always do two different methodologies. So I get validation and verification of the variables that really drive, in this case, rent growth, is what we were trying to, or revenue growth. So I built another model for the metro markets, but what I did was I used two approaches. I used a quantitative multiple regression, cross-sectional regression approach, and then I used a qualitative survey factor where I did a qualitative approach. So I did quantitative and qualitative. Then I designed a survey form based on a Likert scale. Is everybody following me? Likert, 1 to 5. 5 being good, 1 being low. And then basically you go out and you survey people. And I surveyed about 20 professionals in the firm. They basically filled out the survey, asked them about barriers to entry, getting into these markets, some market demand, do they have high concentrations of university airports, office buildings, is there a high quality of life, is the market supplier marketability in the asset, because once we buy the asset, we want to sell it at some point in time, and if we're in a commodity market, we can't sell it, then we're trapped, you know, in the property. And then was it the building strategically located to our other assets? Because what we wanted to do was to build a buying pool. So if I had 2,000 units and 5 properties within a 1 mile radius of each other, I only needed one manager to manage all 5. I could share the maintenance people, and I could do bulk purchases in you know, stuff that I needed to run the buildings. And now we can do negotiations on energy through community choice aggregation. And then do we have rate control units or not?
Do you manage assets that are in
different locations?
New York? Do you have to send someone?
Well, we decided that we didn't want to be in New York or the South or Texas.
A little bit far away, like not in
the
Bay.
Decided we wanted to be just in the Pacific Northwest, California, and the Mountain Desert states. But we sold off Albuquerque and Tucson, and eventually Salt Lake City. So we said we don't want to be east, you know, of Denver, basically. So we set ourselves a geographic constraint because we can get on the plane and be in Denver, you know. Yeah, exactly. So that was one of our constraints. So based on the point scoring system, I was able to create composite scores for the 315 submarkets. So that was my sample size, which is statistically significant. And what I wanted to do was to target submarkets that had very high survey scores and also had high quantitative scores. So I was looking for markets up in here, but I was really looking for this one. High survey score, high quant score. So I basically did this for 14 of our markets. Here's the San Francisco Bay Area plotted. So as you can see, Mountain View, Los Altos, Central San Mateo, Russian Hill, Embarcadero, Sunnyvale, Walnut Creek, Marina. These are all the top markets. You go down here, you're at East San Jose, North Alameda. You know, these are all industrialized. You know, these are not where people want to live, right? These are opportunistic. This is where you would go if you want to flip. Get in, take the heat, invest, and flip. That's one strategy. These are core submarkets. You buy and build here, you're going to make money. You're never going to lose money. Because these are the primo markets. And what you do is if you can't afford to get into these markets, you go into the periphery markets, close to these markets, because the progression is going to probably expand out from these core submarkets at some point in time through regentrification and through progression of development. So this basically validated, again, our strategy and basically gave the acquisition and development teams places where they could focus and not just do deals to do deals, but say, why are you bringing me a deal over here where these are our core markets? So we held them to the fire. And then basically looked at the existing portfolio. We wanted all of our properties to be either in red or orange. If you were out here, then you obviously had to apply higher discount rates or, you know, higher terminal discount rates or lower terminal growth rates or lower growth rates over the investment holding period if you're going to be in these commodity markets.
With the profitable zones that you just showed,
that's what these are.
Why couldn't you also basically build on the fringes of?
Well, that's what I said.
Oh, okay.
I just said that you would target the core markets.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, South San Francisco is orange, but it was really not an established market. Definitely San Francisco and the peninsula.
Mm-hmm.
But South San Francisco is sandwiched in between these two high-density locations. It just doesn't have the economic base, although Genentech and the airport are there to basically provide some economic demand, you know, for those properties. But the product isn't that great, and the pricing's not that great, and the rents are not as high as San Francisco, Marin, you know, or the peninsula.
No, but like I'm saying, for like, you know, you have East San Jose right there that's wedged in between like three different zones.
Yeah,
if
well,
you
this
build...
would be the progression. This would be your opportunistic. These would be your core.
Okay.
Okay. So you could go in here, but you're going to have to justify to us as the investment committee why you went into this yellow zone, that Larry colored zip yellow. Why didn't you get into orange and red? So you better tell us why you're in yellow.
Is there a formula to figure out how like how big of a boom an airport will have on the housing economy?
Yeah. I mean, I would go look at the number of flights that come through the SFO. I'd project out the not only the employment growth rate in San Mateo County, which I can get.
Hmm.
I can also look up on the website and look at the planned expansions by the airport, and then go back in time and figure out how many jobs were created by X amount of money that had been invested in the airport over the last 10 to 20 years, and I can figure it out. And that would be the demand side. That would basically justify a new apartment building construction for us to put in the 20 to 40 million bucks to build an apartment building in San Mateo.
So you could almost say, however much money is invested in the airport, that results in X amount of people.
Yeah, I can figure that out.
Okay.
I can calculate that. That mathematics. That's what they want to hear. Okay. So let's look at the market cycles. So the other one is time diversification. Yeah, you can go into a market, but when do you know when to buy, when do you know when to sell? What are the characteristics of markets? Both commodity markets and supply constrained markets. So that was one of the big questions that these guys asked me. So the first thing I did was I categorized. What are supply-constrained markets and what are unconstrained or commodity markets? So start before I can start doing the tests. So here are the supply-constrained markets, although I would say Portland and Salt Lake City are hybrid commodity slash supply-constrained markets. And then here are the commodity markets. Lots of land, the use of real estate construction is economic development that basically generate jobs. We love to permit all of this construction, and they end up boom-busting throughout their history. Okay, so this was just another justification from a strategy standpoint of what markets we wanted to be in over the long run. So here is the time period. So what I did was I went from peak to trough, trough to trough, and trough to peak. So I basically calculated the time periods between those phases of the real estate cycle for supply constraint and commodity markets. And as you can see, that for the supply constrained markets, peak to peak was 12 years compared to 11, trough to trough, 13 for 11, peak to trough, which was huge, 7 compared to 4, and trough to peak was basically 7. Why do we care about that? This is huge. What you do is you end up getting these red spikes. This is time. This is rent. This is the actual dollar amount, dollar rent. In the supply constrained markets, it takes a long time to go from peak to trough. 20 years, 7? 7 years? So do we want that to be slow?
Yeah.
Yeah, because this is, anybody heard of an integral? The integral? Calculus? Integral? Integral? Integral. You know what an integral is? It's the area underneath the curve. So this is all the revenue that you've basically been able to capture underneath the curve within the supply constrained markets. You go to commodity markets, okay? So you're getting less revenue underneath the curve. So you're collecting more in supply constrained markets than you are in commodity markets. They respond quicker in downturns, not necessarily quicker in upturns. So this was just another justification of our business strategy, shown directly. And we showed two quintessential markets. LA is the quintessential infill location compared to Las Vegas, which has plenty of land. So as you can see, peak to peak, 15 years compared to 8, 17 years drop to trough, and then peak to trough, 7 years compared to 4, and then trough to peak, 8 years compared to 5. So basically, your rents were higher for longer periods of time, therefore your integral, the area under your rent curve, your collections curve, was basically higher. So again, another justification of the theory. Optimization. Okay. Let me get into optimization. So the first thing I need to do before I use the optimization program is I got to build a forecast model using multivariate regression time series analysis. And then I got to forecast what the returns are going to be going out for the next 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years. So what I did was I basically built a model, very simple models. I used a multiple regression model here, supply and demand. And then I used just a demand model, just employment for the blue. And then the red was the actuals. So you can see the green, the multiple regression model with both supply and demand variables, and it did a better job of predicting the actuals, the actual returns, instead of a one variable demand model. So that was kind of the precursor. So then I started running, basically testing the variables and testing the regression models, and came up with forecast models for returns for apartments in the top metro areas that we were looking at. Employment, you can see the T statistic was high. I had population, renter population, I had multifamily permits, and I had affordability. So basically, to forecast total returns on apartments, the key variables were employment growth, renter population growth, multifamily permitting, and housing affordability. I did the best job of predicting, and as you can see from the adjusted R-squares and the F-tests, looked really good. Adjusted R-squares were good. And then the Durbin-Watson meant that if you're close to 1 in the Durbin-Watson, it means that you don't have serial correlation, autocorrelation. That's messing up your error terms. So then, basically, I took the regression model and I forecasted all the returns. And I did it for basically 3 time periods and back-tested the model. These were the forecast rankings, these were the actual returns, these were rent growth, and this was basically occupancy rate for 3 periods. And I back-tested to see if the model did a good job of predicting total returns. And as you can see, the greens are all lumped together, the reds are lumped together. So basically what I could have done was a Pearson rank correlation. Everybody familiar with the Pearson rank correlation? If you want to look at if there's correlation amongst the rankings, right, you're ranking, I'm ranking these by time period, and I want to test the rank correlation amongst these variables within the time periods, I would use a Pearson rank correlation analysis. You might want to write these notes down because I'm basically giving you the master's program, you know, in 2 days. So then I tested them across different time periods, and as you can see, the reds all lumped together, the yellows. So I know my model is good. It did a good job. I didn't really care much about the actual absolute forecasts of the model. I cared more about were the models able to produce rankings over time that were consistent, where we could pick market performance over time, not not notional values of total return, but rank performance over time was really what management cared the most about.
So just looking at this, would 1996 be the best time period because of the grouping of the different things, how like SF Bay Area is all one?
Yeah, because these were the top markets that really popped to the top. We were still basically coming out of a recession in 95. So 96 and 97 were like 2006 and 7, the really strong time periods, and the best markets will always perform and pop to the top.
So that's why like 95, you have like SF Bay Area 3 forecast, but rent growth is way low.
Yeah, this is more of a muddled period, but the demand factors really kicked in here, and the Bay Area just was the... I mean, we were seeing rent growth at this time period in the 20% range. Rents were going up by 20% per year in the Bay Area.
So did this just become more of like a safety check after you've already done all
totally,
of your...
Totally, I'm always checking to make sure that the results are confirmed. Because I'm going to get, did you try this? Did you try that? Did you back test it? Did you, what was the regression model you used? What was the point score model? Were the results consistent? You're going to get 100 questions from the investment committee, and you better be prepared to answer the question. And if you can answer the question, you're in. If you can't, it becomes a little awkward. Right? Embarrassing, awkward. So what I did was I basically took those rankings and I created a rank correlation band. Basically showed that the model that was being used to forecast the rankings, we were in a very tight band and the model did a really good job. Boom. You know, done. So the active approach. So our strategy was to focus on core markets in California and deploy investment capital. What were our forecast variables? Employment, population, housing affordability, permits. Very simple. We set the minimum and maximums for the exposures that we wanted to be in any one of those given markets. If we became over-allocated in any one market, we stopped investing in it. And then these were basically the minimum exposures that we would have in any market. And we could get in and out of a market if it started to turn on us, but we had to set the minimum and maximums. Just like you're doing for your target portfolio, right? And you're going to run it. Our total return targets was 12%, okay? 9% cap rate and 3% capital appreciation for total return. And our focus was on California, because we knew California was the best. So I took the regression model and I forecast it out 5 years, what the total return would be in those markets. I ran the covariance matrix on those returns, put them into the optimization just like you guys did, and then it kicked out basically the portfolio weights for each of the individual markets. So that became the active approach to it. What I didn't do is I didn't calculate the capital allocation line or trace out the efficient frontier I should have done. But you know how to do that. Maybe you work with me with that. But I used a software called Frontline System Solver. It's basically an extension of Excel Solver. It has a little bit more precision and it's a little bit more robust. Okay. So I'll send you some information on that. Okay. Passive portfolio approach. So the next was, well, I can diversify the portfolio geographically, but that doesn't mean you're diversifying the portfolio by economic base. If I have all of my money in Seattle on the east side, and down in San Jose, and in Santa Monica, I'm highly concentrated in the tech sector. Even though I got geographic diversification, I don't have economic base diversification. So I'm not really getting any diversification, only geography. So basically what I did was I broke down each of the individual metro areas by their economic base. Basically looked at the weightings in which they were weighted by industry, and then I created weighting coefficients to test and see how overweighted or underweighted were those metros by industry. So I picked the actual weighting. I actually ran the optimization off the employment time series to get an active approach, And I also ran a passive based on employment in these sectors, add them up, divide them back, and you get the industry production. So this actually gave us information on not only, the other one gave us information on geographic diversification, this one gave us information on economic base diversification. So what we did was we started, now that we had, we ran all the models, we basically knew, what the NOI concentrations would be from the passive approach and from the optimization approach. We came to I worked with senior level managers, and we came up with a target portfolio allocation by geography for the portfolio. They knew they wanted to have $1.3 billion in net operating income coming from the portfolio. So we were able to take, well, actually, I take that back. rewind. Okay. So this is the passive approach. Passive approach was basically estimating the net operating income for the apartments by marketplace. So from information that I got, I knew the occupied units per metro area, multiplied it by the effective rent. I got the operating revenue. So these multiplied gave me the operating revenue. I knew what the operating expense was. I got the operating expense, the revenue minus the expenses, gave me the net operating income. Summed it up, divided it back, these became the passive index weights, just like you would calculate the S&P 500 weights. So it's the same approach for real estate. So what I was doing was taking all the stuff that you were learning in your investments book and applying it to real estate. Okay. Same approach. So now we got the weights, the passive approach. And we have the weights for the active approach. So here was our actual weights from the portfolio. Here was our target portfolio weights, and here was the passive or the indexed approach. So what I did was I basically calculated the difference between the expected and the target, and the expected and the index to get basically the variances. So very quickly we could see that we were severely underweighted in Southern California. And my recommendation was that they would buy $1 billion in Southern California. They didn't believe me at first, but eventually they did believe me. And they basically laid off everybody in Salt Lake City, Albuquerque, Phoenix, sold off the assets, and basically redeployed $1 billion into Southern California and the Bay Area. Because they outperformed. But these ratios, along with the variances, very quickly allowed us to identify where we were under-concentrated and where we were over-concentrated. So we put a moratorium on the ones where we were over-concentrated, sold off some, and then deployed all of our capital into LA and the Bay Area. So once we know the target allocation, we know the actual, we knew that we wanted to generate $339 million of net operating income. So that's all I had to do was to be able to take the weights, right? Take the target weights, multiply it by the target net operating income, and get the dollar amount. Take where we should be targeted. Does that make sense? Okay, let me go back. So we wanted to have $339 million of net operating income. We already knew what the percentages were for the target, so that's all I had to do, just like you did in the portfolio spreadsheet that I did for you, is you multiply the percentage by metro by the target, and you're going to get the dollar amount. You take the target percentages times the target amount, you get the dollar amounts of target. I also went back and audited all of our exposures within the markets, and knew what the net operating income was projected for each of our markets. So that's all I had to do was subtract what our actual was from the target, and it gave us a variance dollar. Do you follow so far? Okay, now we got the dollar amounts. I also knew what the, so I have net operating income for each of the different metro areas. I divided these by the capitalization rate to get the value, net asset value. So in the Bay Area, I could divide this by 5%, 0.05. And Denver, I was dividing it by 0.07. Because cap rates are higher in the commodity markets and lower in the supply constrained markets to get the net asset value for the portfolio. So this is the amount you needed to invest based on the net operating incomes and the cap rates. We also knew with the dollar per unit, how much it would cost us per unit to buy in these markets. So if I take the dollar amount that I need to expose to invest in those markets, divided by the dollar amount per unit, I got the number of units that we need to invest in those metro areas. Most of the projects that we invest in have 250 units in. So I take the number of units divided by 250. This is the number of projects that we need to build or buy in these markets. When I went to them and I said, we need to buy $500 million in Southern California. We need to buy 10 projects. They thought it was crazy. But then within 6 months later, after due diligence, within a year, they said, you're right. We need to invest $1 billion in Southern California.
So was the actual, the targets that you had, and from the variance analysis, I mean, the target was the weights you had, but from the variance analysis?
Yeah, this was the target NOI, and these were the targeted weights that we came up with between the active optimization and the passive approach. And then I sat down with the president of the company and the senior level managers, and we reconciled them and came up with the target allocation. And these became the target.
Got it.
So the target times the target amount basically gave us the targeted NOI. I basically did an audit of the whole portfolio plus all the projects that were coming online in the future, and basically aggregated and audited and put together a net operating income for each of the individual metros based on projections. Follow?
I think the audit's where I get lost, because I don't know how.
Well, I knew that there was an apartment building,
yeah,
that was under construction right now, and it wasn't gonna be delivered this year, it was gonna be delivered next year. So basically, but I knew that the NOI was gonna hit the portfolio. So basically, I had to figure out how much of the NOI was going to be contributed. Let's say if it was a building in Southern California, I had to add in that building's net operating income to our total. So I had to sit down, I had to make projections, you know, based on audited building financials to figure out what the NOI was going to be next year. I had to figure out all the developments, what their NOI was going to be, and basically put together an audited net operating income for the portfolio and the developments going out. Does that make sense? Because
yep.
I wanted it to be forward looking.
Since this is real estate,
same approach to building an equity or fixed income portfolio, same approach, it's just real estate.
So once you get your NOI, are you paying dividends? Are you rebalancing?
It has
to
do with this. This is the underlying real estate. We're not even operating at the REIT security side. We're not even there.
Okay.
Basically, what they wanted to know is, Larry, you've been buying buildings and developing buildings in all of these markets with no strategy, with no empirical research, no research-driven strategy. Our acquisitions and development guys are going out, finding deals, bringing us deals, and a lot of those deals are going bad because there's no underwriting. So build us a macro model. Not only build us a market selection model, but build us a portfolio strategy based on research that we can communicate to the institutional investors and retail investors and the board and everybody, that we have a research-driven strategy that we're not just shooting from the hip on our deals.
Now, with Salt Lake City being zero, is that essentially one, or are you just guys not going to do anything? Because you have a target allocation, but how can you have a target allocation with no projects to invest in?
Yeah, this basically said, you know what, we shouldn't even be in Salt Lake.
So then what did you do with
we sold out.
With the target allocation from Salt Lake to just redistribute it among the rest of the...
Yeah, exactly.
When you redistributed that, did you do it evenly, or did you weight it more towards
the
one...
Well, it was insignificant. It was only 71 units. And we do... This basically said, we need to be in L.A., we need to be in Seattle, we got to be in the Bay Area. These other ones, we really don't care about.
Okay.
You know, it just allowed us to really focus on what we needed to do.
So then did you throw the majority of that 3% target into SoCal and
Seattle?
Yeah,
we went heavy... We got out of Denver, we got out of Phoenix, we sold out of Portland, we sold out of Sacramento, we sold out of Salt Lake. We went into San Diego, but it's a smaller market. It's really good, but it's a small market. And we focused mainly in Southern California, and then the Bay Area, and then Seattle. So it's really three markets. Eventually. Okay. So once you build a portfolio, how are we doing on time? So once you build the portfolio, you got to have an exit strategy. You got to start monitoring the markets. Just like you're a securities analyst, you got stock in your portfolio, you're a corporate bond fixed income person. You got these corporate bonds and you got these stocks in your portfolio. You got to start tracking them. Right? You're tracking them just like you did with the moving average crossover systems. So you have to build basically instruments. So what I did was I basically built an automated system with dashboards for each of the individual markets, some forecasts, some high-level discussions, ranking systems, and then the graphics, major employers, migration, and then here, remember that cycle graph? So I replicated the cycle graph in real time with real time data. And then pinpointed where the market was along the real estate cycle. These all rolled up into a booklet, a quarterly report that was professionally bound, and then sent out to the board of directors and senior level managers with a CD that they could pop into their computer systems to be able to pull it up automatically and then print out the report if they wanted to, but I provided them the reports on a quarterly basis so they were monitoring the markets. So you gotta monitor the markets. Then those sub-markets, remember the Bay Area sub-markets? So I did 315 individual sub-market reports too, that then became the basis for asset management and acquisitions to basically retrieve this data before they go into an underwriting through their intranet. Is everybody familiar with what an intranet is? It's basically your internal internet. It's all cloud-based now. But it gives you, it has all the archived market research updated. We would do, I think the submarkets we did every 6 months, the metros we did every 3 months to update them. But this gave them access to information very quickly. And we tried to automate this as much as possible. I mean, if I did this now, it'd be all automated. So what was the performance of the portfolio? Again, once you build the portfolio, you have to do some performance benchmarking. So what I did was I basically built a performance report. I basically took the actual performance, the updated performance, static performance, and some benchmark performance. So I was constantly testing the actuals by occupancy rate and by rental growth rates. Okay. Then I basically took this sample of data and asked the question, in how many cases did we outperform by occupancy and by rent growth? And look at it on a percentage basis. So we could very quickly, through one chart, say that we outperformed 99% of the time by occupancy rate across all of our markets. And we were outperforming 60% of the time by rent growth. So it was a very quick and dirty dashboard that allowed the board to be able to, and senior level managers, to see if they were outperforming. So you're tracking not only the underlying fundamentals of the markets, but now you're tracking the portfolio performance and seeing where how much are you performing? And this went right back into the asset managers, portfolio managers, property managers, asset managers were looking at this because they were being benchmarked against it. Then you have to make decisions on when you're going to hold and sell. And from 123, you probably don't remember the exit strategy. You want to write this down. This was probably one of the most important things that I took from the Perino book, is that when the rate of change, percentage change, increase in your net present value, the percentage change of the growth rate in your net present value equals the discount rate where you expect a return, that's when you sell. Okay. So it could be rules based. So every year you do a hold sell analysis.
You do it one more time.
Yeah. So every year when you do a hold sell analysis, you're going to run the net present value on the property based on budgeted projections. You're going to calculate the percentage change in the net present value every single year. When the percentage change, percentage increase in the net operating net present value equals the discount rate, that's when you sell. So when the percentage change in net present value equals the discount rate, that's the point in which you sell. Okay. Now, most portfolio managers hold on to their assets because they become emotionally tied to the asset. Management gets emotionally tied to the property. The asset manager gets emotionally tied. The acquisition director who acquired and developed the property is emotionally tied to it. I say, forget the emotion. Motion stuff, let's build a rules-based system, and if the criteria basically says that we need to sell it, we sell it. Because if you hold on to it, you're holding on to an underperforming asset, and eventually it's going to affect the FFO and the stock price if you keep making systematic mistakes. So to do that, you have to put together comparisons between the actual IRR and the IRR from the market. Well, if you're underperforming the market, you probably should get out. The actual versus the market cap rate. So if your income return is higher than the market, that's good. Okay. If your income return on your property is less than that in the marketplace, you're probably underperforming. You're not growing your rents fast enough. So there's something wrong, either with you as the manager or the market, the underlying fundamentals of the market. The actual versus the market net present values. Okay. So you can look at the NAVs, the net present values. And again, if your property is undervalued compared to the marketplace, you're not maximizing the value of the portfolio. There's something either wrong with you, or there's something wrong with the asset, or there's something wrong with the market. And then lastly, market price compared to replacement cost. Is the price of the asset significantly higher than what I can replace it at? Well, I probably should sell it and buy the cheaper product and improve on it. Or is the market price so much higher than what I can construct it at, it's time to sell. Because the assets are, the market values are overvalued. So if the spread gets really wide, it's like we're out, we're selling. Let's pocket the money and, you know, go back into other markets that are coming out of the cycle. Postmodern portfolio theory. So once you built a portfolio, in this case, it was an apartment portfolio. We were shooting for $5 billion, either by asset value or by market cap for the whole company. Once you get the portfolio, you got to manage it. We can diversify across geography. We can diversify across economic base, but can we hedge off the value of the portfolio if we're anticipating a cyclical downturn over the next 3 to 5 years? Can I write forwards and futures and buy the puts on the futures and write the calls on the futures? Can I do that?
Not for real estate.
What do you need to be able to?
An index.
You need indexes, right? So that was basically it. So go for it.
If you were to have implemented this before, you know, way before the 2008 crash, and you got that all in, what would have happened if that with that index with the crash?
I don't think it. Ideally, it, the best time to probably have developed this was 1994. Because we had 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99. You know, that was like the major run-up, you know, in the marketplace. And then we had, what, 2006 through 2000.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a longer recovery period, but shorter than the late 80s. And then, as we know, the 2000 period was only 2006 and 7. So only 2 years instead of 4 years of recovery. So basically, the recovery time periods were getting shorter and the windows were getting shorter. We would have needed to have done this in the 90s to survive.
But so, what if this, would this have survived the 2008 crash with how hard?
No, it didn't.
Well, because you hadn't implemented it yet. What I'm saying is, if you would have
implemented. Well, we had the indexes built.
Oh, you did?
And
okay.
The contracts had gone live on the CME, and we were working with Standard & Poor's, Goldman Sachs, and JP Morgan to basically educate the institutional investors to basically, they were probably, writing the contracts, right? Because they were going short. So Goldman and other investors needed to buy the forward contracts or the futures contracts. It just never got off the ground. Because usually what happens, and you want to write this down, another thing, is when you're developing derivative markets, it's usually the over-the-counter market that develops first, okay? And then the standardized market on the exchange. So first, when you're developing these derivative markets, it's going to be the over-the-counter market that develops first in the notional, and then you have the standardized contracts from the Chicago Mercantile Exchange will come later. We did the other way around. The market actually started in the over-the-counter market based on the competing index, got a little traction in Europe and in Chicago, but we launched with the standardized contract first before the over-the-counter market was developed. That was another one of the mistakes, okay, of the market timing. So Ben, did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. So why don't we do this on Wednesday? Where we walk you through the index construction and then the derivative, property derivative market development. And then, so we should probably be done with this by Friday. And then you can just stick it in your deliverable and be done.